What's up, everybody? It's day 210. 210 Make a Songbringer. And I've got some amazing news. The whole thing works now with this. It renders out all the content. Look how beautiful these shadows are. It renders all the content to a tiny frame buffer and then renders that frame buffer to the screen. So what that means is the game runs. Whoops, sorry if that was way too loud. Now the game runs way faster. It's so much more efficient, especially with the GPU. Because instead of the screen having to render 4 million pixels every time, it only renders 100,000. That's like 47 times less pixels it has to render with the custom shaders. So it's like I can run things like Open Broadcaster, which is actually using a lot of GPU, and run my game, or like record full screen with Screen Flick, even Retina mode full screen, which normally takes a ton of CPU and GPU to process all that retina-sized video and save it to disk while I'm playing the game. So that would slow down tremendously. And now it's quick as lightning. What's up, professional novice? Yo, man. How you doing today? So, yeah, I'm going to get on to making some dialogue above stuff. What's up, Barkor? It's going great. I was just mentioning that the game from yesterday, I was doing all that stuff with trying to get the shadows to be small, and now they're small. See this? Let me take a little screenshot here. I'll show you what I mean. Oh wait, I don't know if that screenshot function works anymore. Yeah, it takes a tiny screenshot because it's revealing what's actually going on. What's up, guys? Arcane, Mars Power, ahoy, ahoy. Yeah, so let me show you again. The game is now running in a tiny frame buffer. So there's actually I created a frame buffer object, and I found all this code from posting on the forums last night. Steve Tramby replied, and so basically it's in the Cocos2DX test code. There's a frame buffer object you can use. So yeah, it totally works. So check it out. I just took a screenshot there. Let's zoom in on the shadows, and I'll show you what I mean. Boom! So we're talking true pixel art now. Things looking really good now and running way faster. So if you look at this, like my screen is 2560 by 1800. That's 4.6 million pixels. And with the custom shaders, a lot of those have to use square roots and things like that. So it didn't solve your lag issues. Oh man, I'm sorry. If only I could solve all of Italy's internet problems. But yeah, so 4.6 million pixels, right? All with square roots and stuff like that they have to calculate. Versus 420 by 240 is only 100,000. So you see what I'm saying? That's 47 times less pixels it has to render. And now, yeah, the game should be running smoother. In fact, let's do something like this. Let's go and change the screen updates per second to be 60, and see if it causes. Usually that would have caused my laptop to turn its fan on. Really? No way. Yes, Azenris, it's totally working. Yeah, it's recompiling right. I'm recompiling it right now with 60 frames a second to see if that can work now. Nice, right on. Cool. I didn't know there was an SDL too. So here's how the code works. Let's get to where it does the FBO. So here's the essence of it all. You do so. I forget his name, but he was suggesting yesterday to use a frame buffer object, right? And it was totally the thing that I had to do. I even had to, I even created a whole GL test project to try and get the whole The frame buffer to be tiny, but the window to be big. And I was messing around with this test project a lot last night. Let me show you what I mean. Yes, there definitely is a big difference between those. Pound define is a macro, which means that it just, the preprocessor, before it even processes it, it goes and replaces those this word, const name, with whatever it's defined to. And then C++'s const int is a lot different because it's an actual type. So these are, it's much more preferable to use const int because you've got, first of all, you've got the type safety, or it's strongly typed. So you know the type of this, right? This, you don't know what the type of it is. It's just that you don't even know because it's pre-processed. It happens before you even get a type. Yeah. So let me comment out all this frame buffer code that I was messing with last night, and I'll show you what. Cool. All right, so this is the project I was testing last night. So it's a very simple GLFW test project, and I even put this on GitHub. So if anybody else is like looking to test out GLFW, here's the link. Yeah, so what I was trying out last night, I was like, okay, is there any way to get GLFW or OpenGL in general, even without GLFW, to create a big window but a small frame buffer? And I figured out basically it's impossible. Every time you go and you change the window size, it also changes the back buffer size. And I even created another project which I could actually edit GLFW's source code, and I found out that it creates an NS window essentially, and the NS window has a backing store, and basically there's just no way to change your frame buffer size. So I had to go try some other things, and thankfully Steve Tramby wrote back on the Coco Studio X forum and all that, and so basically, long story short, here's how you do a frame buffer object in Coco Studio X. I'm getting the frame buffer size from setting it earlier. So I've got my kit set up so I can set the camera flag and a frame buffer size. So you basically just create a frame buffer. I'm creating a new frame buffer. I'm initializing it to the size of the frame buffer, making it always clear to black. And then you create a render target. So you init your render target, attach it to your FBO. I set alias text parameters so it doesn't do any linear filtering or whatever, so it's true pixel art. And then you have to create a depth stencil target for now, but I submitted a pull request to GitHub to Coco Studio X because just with one tiny minor bug fix, you don't even need this. So, and then you basically create a sprite which is going to render. Yeah, Steve does. Yeah, I haven't seen him in a minute, but he's probably busy as heck. But yeah, he's definitely on the Coco Studio X forums a lot. There you go. Yeah, so basically what's happening is after you create all this, you create a camera object, right? And then you assign it your own custom camera flag. And then every time you go and create a sprite, Like, for example, render components. They create a sprite. You basically just set a camera mask. So this camera mask is what's used to decide which camera that sprite is being rendered to. So because we've set up another camera, we can go render other stuff to this camera, which is going to use the frame buffer object that we just created. So basically, it's as easy as this. Once you've got a frame buffer created, all you got to do is go and set a different camera flag depending on what camera you want that sprite to render to. And then so after everything renders to the frame buffer object, it actually goes and it creates another sprite which is going to render the frame buffer object to the regular camera. So what's cool about that is you can do sweet effects. Like you can do whatever you wanted to this sprite to just change the whole screen. Yeah, he definitely is. He's got his own game he's working on. What's up, baby? Oh yeah, I haven't seen Bat Metal yet. I was so busy with this work last night, but I've still got it and I can't wait to watch it. I'm really looking forward to that. It looks hilarious. Yeah, so check this out. We can do anything. Now that there's a frame buffer, we can do some sweet effects, and this sets you up to do any kind of post-processing you imagine. So look at this. This is just rotating the entire screen. We could apply a color to the entire screen. Yeah, and in fact, was that running at 60 frames a second? That might have been. Let's do this even slower. Right? And so this will make it red. You could do your own, like, you could do your own a different shader on top of it. Whoa, Firefox. Hey now. See what I mean? You can do anything. And you can, this kind of reveals what's going on. I actually have, you can put sprites above it as well. So right now I just realized that some of these particles all need to be put on the right camera mask. And there's a sprite here which holds the HUD, and that could be put onto this, that render texture too. What's up, Mike? I'm showing off this new frame buffer, which is rendering the game 46 times less pixels. Instead of having to render 4.6 million pixels on my screen, it only renders 100,000. And I'm showing off that you can do different stuff with it now. You can create your own effects on top of the frame buffer. Yeah, those particles, that just revealed a bug. So there's a lot of things left to update. One of them is this. Let's do it right now. The particles create sprites. They're all little sprites that handle the particles, and they just need to be set up correctly. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, totally, right? Yeah, just from a couple lines of code, and it's way faster. Wait, where does the sprite, what's the parent? Oh, so I think this particles itself. So where it creates the motes. So let's go with this set camera mask kit get camera camera flag. See if that works to make the particles on top on that same thing. What's up, T? I'm working on this new frame buffer. No, not quite. Yeah, cool. So now the particles are rendering on there too. Whoops. So I decreased the frame buffer size. Basically, yes, but I'm creating a second frame buffer. So there's, by default, Cocos2DX creates a window and a frame buffer, right? That's a frame buffer that's as big as the window. It's called the default frame buffer. I'm creating a second frame buffer right here, right? That's much smaller. So yeah, it's this much smaller thing. And then that frame buffer gets rendered to the default frame buffer. So yes, in essence, there's four pixels right near each other. And this will kind of illustrate the issue. Yesterday it looked like this, big windows. Let's get these bigger so you can see what I'm talking about. It's really not, actually. Hello, Headclot. What's up? Welcome to the stream. So here's what it used to look like yesterday, right? When you render shadows, they would look like this because there's so many more pixels that the fragment shader was actually rendering. Like I said, 4.6 million pixels versus 100,000. So here's what it looks like today. Here's a screenshot I just took. And this is what it looks like because it's actually rendering to those smaller, right? That smaller frame buffer. It can actually do all these rad effects, but keep them at a pixel size. So it doesn't have to do these, doesn't have to look kind of too blurry like this. It can look true pixel art like that. And you get the huge performance boost. Yeah, I don't know if it says it's experimental, right? It's still listed as an experimental thing. So it may be a new feature. And I've left it disableable. So if I go to my settings and I go disable FBO, it should run the game. I haven't tried this yet, but it should run the game exactly as it was. Yeah. So this is the game running at exactly how it was. You can tell because the shadows are big and blurry. And also it's slowing down a lot because it's rendering so many pixels. But if I can easily turn that back to the default where it is using the FBO, just in case this truly is an experimental thing. I think it is pretty important, but only to pixel art games. And there's really not that many games that are actually pixel art these days. So it's not like it's front and center on Cocos2DX. But if anybody's interested, I did start a forum post about it. So hopefully people will be able to find this forum post later and like figure out how to do it in their game too. Yeah, they look so much better now, huh? Yes, exactly. That's what I wanted, pixel shadows. No, I'm not going to allow resizable windows. It's just going to be a full screen. This is a full screen windowed mode though. So let's check it out. If I run the game, this is windowed mode, so I can easily alt-tab out and go to other things. Is there some reason why you prefer to have a windowed mode? Yeah. Wow, nice, Teak. That's crazy. Yeah, huge performance boost. So I've never done this before because I always had to render the game or run the game at 30 frames a second because of all these performance issues. But so now the game is compiled for 60 frames a second even in debug mode. I'm going to run around in the game and see if this is going to make my laptop's fan turn on. That's kind of my like indicator for that the game is using a lot of GPU, cuz that always used to happen. So 60 frames a second, here we go. No, Headclot is definitely not Mac OS X specific. It's cross-platform. Yeah, thanks, Mars Bauer. Wow, it's definitely running a lot smoother. I'm not sure if it looks smoother for you guys because the stream has to run at 15 frames a second to be the right, to not consume too much internet or whatever. But on my screen, it's totally 60 frames a second. And so far, my GPU fan is not kicked in. Let's get to an area with like a bunch of particles or something. Okay, my fan is definitely turned on now. So, okay, I guess the effect isn't... It's definitely improved the performance a lot, but it even at 60 frames a second, it's going to kick in that fan. So I think I'm going to turn it back to 30 frames a second for now. Five thousand spiders, yeah. Oh, interesting. Oh, thanks, T. I'll have to check that out. Cause I'm doing that on Windows as well. It's full screen windowed. Oh, I see what you're saying, like make an opacity effect when you walk behind stuff. I don't know. I'm really kind of on the fence about that one. I kind of prefer the not doing that. But I know a lot of games do that. I don't know. I really don't know what to do with that. Hey, what's up, Vlad? Yeah, DC Zelda, totally. The shadow thingy is totally fixed now. So this is basically sped up the speed of the game stream. The stream for me, because it used to eat up a lot of the GPU, but now it's not. So I can stream better. I can run the game faster. Everything's awesome. What's up, Begloff? What's up, Jonah19? Yo. Yes, if monsters are behind stuff, then you do get hit. So that's kind of right. It's that's the balance of it all. I'm not exactly sure. Yeah, there is an option for that, Teak. If I do windowed mode, full screen, it actually does full screen. But if it's full, then it's full windowed. Or if it's empty, it's also full windowed. Yes, totally. Celebration day. I am going to do some stuff today, but yeah. Nice, right on. What? Nice, right on. Hype for sure, dude. Awesome, Unreal. Oh, we got to see some... does it have like a camera on it too? Is that how those work? Are they like drones? That sounds cool. Yeah, hopefully. Yo, what's up, Ninja Kiwi? Yo! Welcome, welcome, welcome. Oh yeah, I could do another little explanation for how this works. So basically, you create a frame buffer object, right? So the window is going to be big. On my screen, it's 2560 by 1800. But then you create a tiny frame buffer. This technique is really only applicable to pixel art games or any game that would want to do their own custom frame buffer object for post-processing. So you create a frame buffer that's really tiny, and then you add a render target to it, and you basically create another sprite, which is going to render that frame buffer into the regular screen or the regular frame buffer. So there's two frame buffers There's the default frame buffer, which is big, and there's a tiny frame buffer where I render everything else. And all I've got to do is create another camera, and then whenever I create a sprite, I make sure and use the camera flag for that smaller frame buffer, and it just works. Everything is cool. Everything gets rendered into that tiny frame buffer. The shadows look awesome. It does 46 times less pixels of work for all the custom shaders. And then basically after it renders into that camera, it takes that sprite, which uses the texture of the frame buffer, and renders it to the screen by stretching it linearly, nearest neighbor, so it just all looks pixel art. Yeah, I stream at 15. Yep. Nice, right on. Well, cool. I can't wait to see some videos then. Yes. All right, so let's start. Okay, I'll only show you the first issue I want to work on. Or not the first issue, but like the next issue. It's okay, if I just get up and I truncate this whole thing. If you watch the dialogue, it actually sometimes jitters a little bit. So if you see, as I move and there's dialogue, sometimes you can see that it's not pixeled perfectly. It's not aligning all the text to the pixel. So I need to create, and besides also, if you create, if you're doing text and there's something else that gets in front of it, like if there's a tree, or like that, see what I mean? There. So if you're standing in front of something, the dialogue should always be on top. So there's two issues with the dialogue, and I'll start handling those now. Basically, yeah. But basically, every time it renders the scene, which is like 60 times a second, it's snapshotting every single time. So it's not always the technique that you would want to do in a game, right? Especially if you're already rendering everything at full screen, you wouldn't really want to do that because this is kind of taking extra time. It's a technique called, I just said the word a second ago. Post-processing, it's called post-processing. All right, so I think I'm going to do this by creating a dialogue component. And then the dialogue component will just follow. Follow the entity around the render component that it's attached to. That way it can always be on top of everything else. I think it's a layer color that the anims are using. Yeah, layer color. So this is going to be great because it's not going to have to re-render the layer every single time. It creates a new dialogue entity. And I guess we can just pass in a parent. Yeah, and we'll do a bool active as well. So is empty is going to be not active. And no need to find, no need to get ids. So I can start processing that or compiling that. And then we create the dialog component. Right, so active equals parent is not null, and if we're not active, we can return from this constructor. Otherwise, we'll just create the layer, and I guess we'll create the other stuff that goes along with the layer too. Yeah, it totally scales, King Nothing. Check it out. You can kind of tell by looking at everything here, but it's basically running a hell of a lot faster. But if you can see, the shadows are actually pixel perfect now. And you can also tell in the light beams. The light beams really reveal that there's a furry fuzziness almost to the light beams now. And I do want to try rendering the light beams actually on top on the regular frame buffer so that those will look more high quality. I guess I'll be cheating in that sense. It won't be pixel perfect. But at least the shadows will look cool, and at least the game is running a hell of a lot faster. Yes, totally. Yes. Yes, Jonah19, true. Anything can technically have a dialogue component and be able to talk now. What? Really? What's up, Shire Monkey? I'm working on a dialogue component right now. Wow. Crazy. All right. So in the enims, it goes and it creates these layers and the box and all this stuff. So we need to go and kind of move a lot of this code into the actual dialog component next. Yeah, I would. Yeah. Disco barrel. All right, well, all that really needs to be inside this create is all this triangle, the label, and all that. Unicorn? And I just realized that this dialog component probably needs to access to its label as well. Yeah. We need a label. So we need a layer color, the layer that this belongs to. Yeah, which needs to be resized. And then the label. So label. Wow. close to exactly 4 on mine. All right, so yeah, now we've got the label as part of that. We want to go layer. I wonder if I can just initialize this like this, like layer. Is a kit layer color? No, I don't want to do that. Yeah, it's probably better to use a pointer in this sense. Either that. Oh, yeah, probably just a pointer. All right. Pointer it is. There you go, good point. Ooh. Oh, Coin 54, we're talking about what worked is the this whole, I'm using a frame buffer now to render everything. So here's what it looked like yesterday. Big window. So this is what the shadows look like yesterday. They're not pixel art. And it's doing a lot of work to render all those shadows, right? Because look how many more pixels there are it has to render. And now it's super smooth, super fast, and is true pixel art. So that's what worked. It's using a frame buffer to accomplish that. All right, layer color pointer. This can make that easier. And a label pointer as well. Oh, we need SIDs as well for this, so don't forget the SID. SID. Dialogue component. All right. Now, this should go like this. The layer and the label need to be defaulted to null. There, now we're safe again. And now we can just go layer equals that. Yeah, it's a lot prettier, right? What do you mean by manage the assets? What do you... Yeah, what exactly are you talking about by managing assets? All right, DC Zelda, good night, man. Sid from Final Fantasy. Who's giving out royalties here? I want the royalties too. What's up, CX00? Welcome to the stream, man. Yeah, we'll just go 0000. Size dot width, size dot height. Really? This doesn't matter. It's going to make it 1x1. Offset also doesn't matter. All right, royalties for everyone now. Oh, do I get it? Meanity and mean real. Oh, loading and unloading. Yeah, Kogo Studio X, does do most of the work for that. But yeah, I do load at the very beginning of the game because mine's a pixel art game. So I can basically cache the sprite frames I'm going to need most often. So really there's only three things I need, and that's these three big sprite sheets. That there's a common one like this. This is the biggest one. It has a lot of sprites in it. And then there's also backgrounds. You know, all these common ones are just cached immediately. And so Cocoa Studio X does do the heavy lifting part of it all by loading all that. Yeah. That's so great. Wasteful? Well, not really, because it's pixel art. This is a really tiny texture. And secondly, my game uses it all the time. So, in some cases, what you'd want to do, I did this for my last game, you'd want to go cacher, I think it's unload, or remove. Yeah, you can remove sprite frames by name. You can remove overall textures and everything. So if you really wanted to, you could keep track of what you've loaded and then unload it all once you're done with that certain scene where you don't need it. So, but this game, I don't even need to do that at all because it's such small art. All right, so let's create the label. Label equals I don't even need label glitch anymore. So layer is the parent. Font. Text, empty to start with. Margin, this is the position of it all. I guess we should make this a constant then. So go const float k dialogue margin, because we're going to use this in several places. I think this should be 7.0. Vec2. All right, let's get that compiling. Yeah. Right? Yeah, writing a whole asset system is a big task for sure. We got like another crazy scorcher today. Hot day. Serp. So we're going to adjust the size of the box later when we actually create an M. And then this triangle, dude, get rid of it. Oh, I can't see the code. So in direction of layer for that, try to set color. We'll also need to do Doesn't really matter what color it's set to there. And also, it's opacity we don't need to worry about. So, yeah, okay, we just do this. There. Yes! Do it! Do they have tiny Nerf guns? So, boiling it down, this is really all these dialogue opponents are going to need. Yes, dude. If there is, oh, it'd be so great. Or a water gun. I guess water guns might be a little heavy. What about a rubber band slingshot? What's up, Sean? It's crazy. You're crazy, man. Alright, so next thing, we need to be able to have dialogue components for the entities. So I want to be able to do this by using the create being method, but for now, I'll just go dialogue component, and this is area layer, apparent. Oh. There, so both Jib and Rock have dialogue components now. Only a little, only in a good way. Alright, so now we're going to go to NIMS and start using these dialogue components. We should grab the dialogue way back here. Autoref dialogue equals entity get dialogue component for id. And then test it too. So if dialogue component or is dialogue dot is empty, we'll return from this method. There, so now we've guaranteed that this entity we're going to run this on has a dialogue component. Oh, there you go. Yeah, just make your own. Really? Tiny Nerf guns are expensive? It's a racket. The tinier they are, the more expensive they are. It's just like buying bikinis for girls. All right, so now that we have this dialogue component and it's like, we need to be able to set, we need to set a few things like background color, dialogue dot layer, set color, box color. We need to set its size. Oh, how do you set the size of a layer? Well, that's a good question. I think it's set content size. Yes, the thing does the thing now, man. No, no worries, man. Dude, if you've never bought a bikini, trust me. They can be really expensive. Yeah, so Grimgarry, you were here when you were seeing it yesterday. That's what the shadows look like. Here's what the shadows look like now. Sorry, I'm in the middle of writing some code and stuff like that, but I would show you. But you'll see it in a sec. But yeah, these are what the shadows look like now, and the game is way faster, especially with the GPU. Yes? Whatever that is. You have a beer bot? Oh, dude. Jealousy. Envy. That's so great. Oh, man. So rad. Yeah, right? Sean, it's crazy? Yeah, so this is a simple technique, too. I did start a forum post about it on Kogo2DX, so if anybody's also interested in doing it, you should be able to find my forum post. But basically, you just create a frame buffer that's going to be rendered really small, right? You create a small, tiny frame buffer, and then that you render everything to that tiny frame buffer, and then that gets scaled up to the regular size of the frame buffer when you're done. So instead of rendering 4.6 million pixels with the custom shader, it's now only rendering 100,000. So hence the 46 or 47 times less work that the GPU has to do. Oh man, student life forever. Oh, it's pan-European. Yeah, I wonder what this is going to get, because I know I'm going to get all these ratings when I go on to Google Play, right? If I end up doing Android. 18, huh? May contain graphic violence. I don't know what this game will be. Oh. Sorry, man. Sorry in advance if that ends up happening. But I kind of hope it does. I kind of hope I lose a bit of my life in this game when I play it, you know? Like, I'm really, this is the game that I want to play the most. So, I can't wait till it's done and I can finally kick back, put my feet up, kick back on my couch, crack out my gamepad and play this game. Right? Oh, yeah, yeah. Sorry, it's been like 15 minutes since I did that. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and just guess that this is the right thing to do. Size. That's how big you should be. Oh, it also needs an offset. Dialogue layer. Set position. I guess I'll comment that out for now. I know, I hope not. I might have to take a little break. Take like a week or whatever and go climb a mountain or something, and then come back and play it. Usually that's what happens when you write a game, right? Because at the end of writing a game, you're having to just test it a ton. You're just testing it, fixing bugs. It's a lot less creative. So, yeah, usually the last few months are kind of hard on the old, like, freshness of your mind type thing. I will. I think it said dialogue.label. Said, BM font? Yeah, BM font file path. There it is. So font. Nice. Right on. I think we can make that happen. Oh, man. I think this can happen. Right? The glasses, right? I think my girlfriend might even have these glasses already, but the pink wig, that's not that expensive. You can get one of those online for like $15, right? I'm guessing. Set string to be text. Okay. That might be all that's necessary for that one. And then we need to adjust the size of the box. So we need size equals dialogue.label get content size. Wigger foo. Nice one. Just forget the wig and dye my hair pink. That could happen. That could happen. I'm thinking if this game does really well, I might even shave my head. Oh yeah, it is. Layers set content size. And set position X. All right. See, here's something we forgot, though. The triangle needs to be edited. Damn. I know. You got the evidence. That's why I've said it. On the stream. Right? I got to put my money where my mouth is. It's like a dare, kind of. I guess we just call that try. It's probably might be more. Yeah, it's a little more appropriate or general. Oh man, there's definitely been other ones I definitely didn't want them to come on YouTube. What were they? The one time I got trolled so bad. Oh my god, I wanted that one to be like, do I have to upload this one? But I did. There. All right, so we've initialized it to null. We're saving that so we can modify the triangle later here when we're creating the dialogue. So try.setColor. We need the try access. Access the try. Which one was that? I don't know. What were we talking about that day? This guy came on, he was being such a dick. He was this like zombie troll. He came back from life. I know about what month it was. But I don't remember exactly what video it was. But I know it was around the time that where the Kickstarter was going on. And it was right after the Kickstarter started. So it would have been about day 100 or 107, like day 107 around there. This is my guess. Oh, look, I have two day 107s. That's probably wrong. But yeah, I don't know. It's around there somewhere. There's this one troll, dude. It's really not that entertaining to watch unless you're a hater that loves hate. Yeah, he was really bad. Thankfully, there was a lot of people on the stream here that were defending me from this troll, because this guy was super dick. And he kept coming back. We had to ban him. I wasn't the only one banning him. There were some four horsemen in here banning too. And Banim comes back. He was literally a zombie troll. Dialog.sprite, set color, layer.getColor. Trolls, right? Freaking trolls. Yeah. Brad was here. Brad was on the stream. Brad was definitely giving him the business. You know how direct Brad can be. So, yeah. It can be. Right? Totally. And I would have gotten away with it too if it wasn't for you kids. Set position back to this. Okay, I do believe this is mostly it here. We need to do this action here for the sprite and the label. Eat the roll. Eat the roll. Eat the sushi roll. Eat it. Rolls have got like a sushi roll in the game. What's it do? Is it just like River City Ransom where it gives you strength or whatever? What's up, Caviarux? Welcome to the stream, man. Talking rolls, talking rocks, everything can talk now. It's the future. We've finally gotten to the future. Oh, here, one more. Dialog.layer. All right, so does anyone think this is actually going to work on the first try? Who votes? Jim does a barrel roll? Hey, wait a minute. That's actually a good idea for his stun. How about also I like this whole idea of talking rock, waterfall, or something. Easter egg. What? Has it been a while? Sorry, man. Did you change your name? A bowel wall? Thanks, Sean. Let's see what happens. If this actually has dialogue on the first try, I'll be surprised, actually. Oh, look, it's there, but it's in the left bottom left corner. Oh, obviously. We need a position for all this now. Oh, crash. Crash on exit. What? Oh, because of label. Looks like the dialogue. Oh, we don't want to remove. We don't ever want to remove these. Yeah, let's turn that off. Oh, all right, cool, man. Well, welcome back, then. Welcome back. Oh no. Did I try an argument? Oh, did he try an argument? He must have. It's Mars of Power. He's got Mars of Power. Okay, is there any more remove self calls in here? Oh, yeah, we don't need to do this. Basically, we've already faded this thing out, so we shouldn't need to. Yeah, that should work. All right, and I think what's going on is it needs to set the, it needs to fade in, of course. Oh, this needs an opacity. Dialog.layer, set opacity to 0, and then that'll enable it to fade in, right? So it'll go delay time, ease exponential, fade to, create, blah, blah, blah. And it also needs a position overall for everything. So layer is box offset plus equals the position of the entity. Oh man, I might be able to get rid of this kid pixel thing. If you can't beat him, eat him. Yeah, I know. Oh, well, I don't know. CodeLite. Is CodeLite good? Who makes CodeLite? All right, now we got some dialogue. We have the triangle thing, but it's on the left side of the screen. Oh, he's still getting this crash, too. Well, you can't have your cake and eat it, too, right? I have no idea how that saying applies to this situation. Bread time! Oh, just right. I can't have a roll. So what is it? Why is every... Oh, wait. Oh, because it's set position X down here. Oh, duh. So I guess we'll just add position X, dialog, set position X, dialog, get position X. Man, the next thing will be to tackle what's going on with the background color. Can you roll a cake? I don't know. Can you? It's cool, huh? CodeLite. All right, cool. We got positions. It's not fading out correctly. It's not playing the right text. Oh, obviously, it's doing the same. Oh, it's setting the same. Okay, so we need to wait a while till we apply the text. Right? Yes, I've done that. Kind of reminds me of Eclipse a little bit. There you go. There's rolled cake. Mars power has got to be part of your. Yes, yeah, I know. Yes, I was actually looking at this last night, Caviarux. I created this little test project for GLFW, but it's called your viewport, right? So if I make the viewport, okay, here's my little example project for spinning a triangle around. If I make my viewport really, really tiny, check it out. If I do, let's say, a quarter of the size for my viewport, it's not going to change my window size. It's just going to change the area where OpenGL draws. So, and then the next thing you want to do, if you want to make it really big, that's no problem. Let's say I want to make it twice as big. You just change your viewport size. So there, it's the window's the same size. My viewport's really big. Oh. Well, cool. Yeah, I know, I'm getting hungry too. You guys, oh, I'm getting so hungry. Yes, yeah, you're welcome, man. Yeah, I hope that helps. And if you want to, this project's online too. I posted the link a second ago, but, not a second ago, but, you know, earlier I posted this little link. But yeah, you probably already have your own project, but this is a little test project for GLFW. Yeah, totally, totally. That's why I use Cocos 2DX, for sure. Handles all that stuff. But it's also tricky to do things where you're like, you know, like doing this frame buffer thing. Okay, here's where we'll do all of this stuff. We need to do all of this setting of the properties within a lambda. So a delay the prior delay, then call a func. Which does all this stuff. Sets the opacity, sets the color. Actually, let's just do fade in. Or we can do a fade to create. It's zero long. And fades to zero. There, that's what we'll do. So we don't need to do this set opacity. Oh, and I guess we could tint to and set the position to. Oh man, we could do a lot of this stuff without having to do that. Yes, yeah, it will. no, it uses GLFW and then it directly uses OpenGL after that. So GLFW creates a window, and then everything is pure OpenGL after that. Yeah, there's no SDL. Yo, what's up, Troop Sandwich? This is best three words of like greeting I've ever heard. So great. Yeah, this will work. So we want to set the color and, but not the position. So we'll go tint to. What's up with this? Tint to create. Doesn't like this. Tint to create. Oh, now it's fine, huh? Create. Oh, doesn't like this. But oh well, and I'm pretty sure it's 0.0, and then I give it the box color. There, now I don't need to do that, and I don't need to do this, and I don't need to do this. Yeah. I know, man. Xcode autocomplete just gets worse with every release, man. I guess I'm probably exaggerating that. But I just wish it worked. It used to work in Xcode 4, and then 5 it broke. 6, it's still broken. Good question. Alright, so this is going to need to be part of... all of this. Okay, get rid of that. Get rid of this. We don't need any of this stuff. I trust this is working. Right, so yeah, now we got this boiled down to just this little bit here. We can go and put all this into this this little lambda function. Actually, yeah, especially Visual Studio 2015. It's really good. Really, really great. Yeah, I just got beta 6. I haven't even tried any of the Xcode 7s, but I'm going to try that out later on. Apparently, I need to fix my projects to work with something. I forget what it is. Yeah. Yeah, any kind of blind following is crazy, right? Blind faith. Blind faith in general. Alright, we'll capture his jib. That's just a boolean. We want to capture the text. We'll need to re-get the dialogue, or just get a D. Oops. So we're doing now. There you go. Yeah, it's true. I'm pretty sure you do. We need the size variable. Unless. Nah, we don't need the size variable. We just capture it there. We don't need that. We need K, this should be K dialog margin. Whew, I didn't know it was going to be so much work to create dialog components, but this will be worth it. It'll be sweet to see waterfalls talking. So what essentially happens is you're creating a class with the Lambda function, and that class does get, I'm pretty sure it gets destructed. That's a good question, Mars Power. Yeah. Huh. Whoa. Oh. There's that one. System and F, and we'll go F here. And why is it not liking this call func create? Box offset dot y. We don't need to do this anymore either. Yeah. Thanks, Azimus. What is it not like about this? No matching function call. That's it. That's all you're going to give me. Oh, here's the problem. Funny. All right, cross your fingers once again. Dialogue components, come on. Oh, we have an immediate crash. Damn. What? Letter J. Oh. Okay, well, this makes sense. We do need to actually set the text. Wait a minute. No, all of this needs to be inside that lambda. Oh man, this should be now a new function, I think. Okay. Before I go and make this a separate function, I'm actually just going to do it this way. So we've captured text already. We've got dialogue. We don't want to do this prior delay for any of this. In delay per, we can capture that for now. Or just put it in here. Oh, and actually, these are kind of nice to have at the top, all in one place. So we'll capture in delay per and letter duration. Word count. Oh, we need to capture word count. Duration. Text color. Yeah. R2, what's up, R2? Yeah, it's true. Everybody's using Borland. Oh, cool. Hey, at least he's saying the right words now. Huh, okay, let's figure out what. Oh man, it still crashes. Oh. It's not working. Caviar, is there anywhere else in your code? Yo. Okay, why is the layer not visible? The layer color. Wait, maybe it's because it's created and it's totally transparent. What if it were just black? The triangle's there. Oh man. Boo. And I guess this thing should have a really, really high put that at 2,000. It shouldn't appear behind the trees anymore. All right, Marza. Good night, man, Marza. There, now at least the text is on top of the trees. If I move around, it does appear somewhat near my head. That's actually wrong. Oh, it's definitely not doing the right offset. Oh, this is annoying having this all die like this too. Because the layer is getting released on exit. Yeah, well, what's this window rendering thing, though? Inside here, is there anything that would be calling GL viewport? Oh, you already got it? Right on. Nice. there you go. Dude, this has got to be the slowest one ever. What if these are all red? Then this didn't have anything to do with the actual. Maybe it's the size. Oh, that crash is getting annoying. Okay, let's leave that to zero. Let's try something like making the box really big. Not really big, but sort of big. Position zero. Anchor points. Anchor points for layer colors are different. Still nothing. Ah, yeah. Come on, come on. I can figure this out. Okay, for sure I can at least figure out the problem is with the offsets. The offset on X. F.position.x. No, we don't need that. That's the problem. And then what else with the, let's see if that worked first before I confuse myself with something else. It's like, it's just the layer itself is not getting, it's not fading in. Okay, cool. Yeah, so now they're aligned with their heads. That's good. Bug. That was the whole time. That was label. It was supposed to be layer. Let's see if this works as it should now. And then we should gotta get it to not die. Why is it dying? Yes! Oh! Oh, cool. The sprites are even the right color. All right. Yes, that's awesome. Oh, yeah, that might have been it. But it was, yeah, it was just that. I had a super duh bug. Right. I know, that's what that one was right there. Okay, sweet. All right, we got dialogue components. What happens if I go here and then quit? Yeah, we still get this whole layer. So the thing is, layer. Wait, is this layer node? Layer color, layer node, label. So essentially, label is the thing that's eventually crashing. So wait a minute. What if we create this? If we retain, we go. Label retain. Okay. Oh, that worked. Okay, I'm just gonna highlight this as like, what the fuck? You know, this is like, what? WTF? Why do I need to do that? I don't know. I'll think about that later before I check in. But at least now it's not crashing. It's not crashing. We got dialog components that are working. Yes. All right. Cool. Okay, now we can move on to the more things like well, that was weird. See that? His blue text was really weird looking. Wait, the B didn't fade in. Oh, this is weird. That's weird too. Well, get some things to work, some things don't. What's up, Enoa? Fearless Hyena, what gear do I use for making music? I use an M Audio trigger finger. Can you see this? It's just a little pad where you can. It's pressure sensitive, so you can play your drums like whatever you play. You're getting pressure sensitive, velocity sensitive notes out of it. So, and then I use some Steinheiser headphones. And I have a suitcase drum set, which I haven't used for any drums yet, but I have guitars galore. I have electric guitar, electric bass, an acoustic guitar. And then I have my voice too, but I'm probably not going to use that at all in this for this game that much because I just don't think voices sound very good in game music. I know. I don't know why it's missing characters. I'm really wondering that too. It's just like the every I think it's the fade in probably. Yeah, it's not, this isn't double byte. You know what? What if I take that out? Let's just check this first. Yeah, there's the R was missing and wrong. But B is missing in piss. It's got to be like it's not fading it in correctly, I bet you. Oh, good point, King Nothing. Should be double byte. You're telling me alien languages aren't Unicode? Yeah, it's got to be this fade-in thing here. See, it's fading in each letter. And then it fades out the letter. So, what if we make the minimum delay half a second? Let's see if those words now appear. Not always, but yeah, typically you would put all your class declarations in an H. That's a good point, right, Caviar? I mean, I'm not so worried about people hacking this game. Ugh, the R is still the mid. Yeah, I think if somebody's going to go through the effort to hack the game that much, they're going to easily find that the story is in plain text anyways in the strings file. You know, they can read the whole story and read that Jib is saying stuff. Like, Jib actually does say stuff, right, you know, for each one of these lines. So I'm not so worried about it. If a person really wants to hack the game, they're going to hack the game. No, they're real characters. They're real characters that I made up, but they're actually just one to one, like to the regular English alphabet. So A maps to an exact alien font letter. B maps to another letter. Yeah, it's just English basically. Yeah, that's Azarus is putting it better here. No, it just started happening when I did this, though. You know, it was working 2 seconds ago, so it's got to be something to do with this new animations and stuff. Like this, if I just totally disable the fade out of each letter. Oh, man. It has to do something to do with reusing the same label. It's gotta be like, it's gotta be that. It's gotta be. Yeah, I could do that, but that would reduce the joy someone would find when they actually hacked the game. I don't know. I might. That's a really good question. I gotta balance this, right? I think in general, most people are not ever gonna open up the assets folder and even look at it. I'm gonna guess over 50% of people are not ever gonna do that. But to the people that are gonna open it, they're probably gonna access most of the files, even if it isn't just a text file. I don't know. That's a really good question. Really good point. Both you guys are making good points here. No, it's not. It's not at all heresy. Yeah, ROT13's an easy way to encrypt. I don't know what I've been streaming. I kind of got to get going soon, guys. My head's hurting. But let's see if I can give it 5 more minutes to try and fix this bug I think it's with reusing letters. So if I don't even do any of this, no. Yeah, see? There. It's got to be something to do with that. Because if I don't do any of this code to fade in the letters and fade out the letters, then it's fine. So something is wrong in here. Technically nothing, well, I'm assuming nothing has changed since I moved this code into this lambda function, but maybe something has changed. Oh, this is being called. Yeah, we've already set the string. Okay, so we know we're dealing with the right letters. That's what I'm thinking, Arcane. Yeah. All right, I think this is the case for printf or logging. I have no idea what's wrong here, so I'm gonna try and just look at the numbers. Okay, so we're gonna go text. Delay in. Delay text dot subser 0.9 maybe dot cster delay in delay. There, so that'll print off a little bit of something for each letter so we can look at them all. It might be, is it? Printf everything. Sometimes north. The word foo originated as a nonsense word from the 1930s. Wow. You only 55%? Yes, yeah, Lighter Thief, what's up, man? Lighter Thief, check us out. Here's yesterday, what the shadows look like. Here's today. Shadows are nice and pixely. Boom. And the game runs hella fast compared to what it did yesterday, especially with the GPU. Yeah. There, so if only you were wrong, the R doesn't show up. Why is that? Oh, I should have at least said the. Oh, look, the delay's reversing. So I need to know the percent D of percent D, like this is J of text dot size. Correct. Yeah, totally right. No, Caviar, no, I didn't fix it with the viewport. I tried that. I tried the entire day trying to fix it with the viewport, basically by just setting, I tried to make it so that the screen was big, or the window was big, but the frame buffer was small. That's impossible. I tried everything. There's no way to get your frame buffer to be different than your window size, at least in GLFW. So the way to do it is to create a small, tiny frame buffer, render everything to the frame buffer, and then just render that frame buffer up by scaling it up. So that makes it way more efficient. Like instead of rendering 4.6 million pixels, the game only renders 100,000 pixels. So way more efficient. And it looks better, in my opinion. Yeah, right? I know, maybe I shouldn't have my taskbar up there, huh? Would that be helpful? If I turned off my taskbar, would that be cool? All right, let's see what it looks like now with all that J and text size in there. There, if you only were wrong. Wait, did it go W wrong? Did it insert a space? Is that what it was? Hold on, I gotta see that again. Oh, all right. You can hide the taskbar in El Capitan? Sweet. Yes, I love it, right? I missed it. Yes. Jib love. I gotta make the player's shadow ink scooch up a little bit when he's on the ground. Oh, okay. So it is W Ong. So R. Oh, you know what? Now I need to know what letter each one of these is. Okay, so percent C. Gotta love printf, man. So I'm going back to my roots right now with printf. Text J. 64%? Dude, it went up like a lot in the last few minutes. Yeah, good for you, I'm Perix. Or is it Perry? Yeah, the reason C++ isn't fast compiled is because the preprocessor is kind of lame. Thankfully, they have modules now, but they're not. Nobody knows how to use modules yet with C++, it seems. Oh, look. Look at this. If space, only space, you space, were no space, wrong. That's something, right? Were 15, it skips letter 16. It doesn't like letter 16 at all. What? Wait a minute. What if it's. I guess it's skipping the letter because the sprite's not there. No, wait. I'm not removing the sprites, am I? No. Of course not. Man. Yeah, exactly. Because of all that preprocessor overhead stuff. Is it? No, it's. Wait, is it? Is 16 a new line? Maybe. No, it can't be because the W is the one on the next line. Or is it? So we've got text. Before we start all this. Yeah, you're right. It must have something to do with that because 16 is the line break width right there. Yeah, there's no more pipes, so I got rid of those pipes, right? So I used to have pipes in here, but now there's no pipes. You just specify all of your text as one string, and then it goes and it line breaks it out based on how many characters. You guys are right. It's got to have something to do with this line break. It's processing the text before captures it. Oh man, this is one of those things where if I had a clear mind, I would be like, I would know what's wrong right away. But I'm kind of like at the end of my rope for my energy levels right now. Yeah, good night, man. Have a good eat. I gotta get some food too. I think that's one problem. I just need food. Yeah, good night, Jonah. Yeah, I'm gonna cut the stream short right now, anyways, because this is something really simple. I'll figure this out later on, way easier than trying to hit my head against the wall right now with this right now. But you guys, thank you for mentioning that with the 16, the new line, and all that. It's probably that, something to do with that. So I'm sure later on I'll figure this out and be like, oh, duh. And then I think I'd like to also turn this into a separate method to clean this up and make this method a lot not inside this huge Lambda and all that. So it might just be the Lambda. Who knows? So yeah, thanks again, you guys. And bye-bye. We'll see you next time. Later on, everybody.